Hello, Battlerite fans, and welcome to Champions at Dawn. I'm your host, ShadowFury333, and this week I am joined by...
My name is Pharos, the most recent addition to the PRL casting crew. Thank you, Shadow Fury, for having me, and we're going to practice some commentary and have some fun.
Yeah, so today we're going to be doing a bunch of in-houses with most likely JD14. Well, this match will be JD14 and White Crayola against Lion Doorknocker and Vapid, of course. So yeah, we have like White Crayola on Rook with JD on Sirius against LDK on Pearl with Vapid on Croak. And I believe Vapid will be going on Croak forever. JD, as far as I could tell, is pretty flexible. White Crayola, not totally sure. And LDK is apparently a really good Bakko player, but is playing Jade right now.
Yep, JD's pretty flexible. His Shifu's really high up there in the skill levels. I really like this Sirius and Rook combo, though. They can unleash devastating amounts of burst with Rook's armor break debuff combined with Sirius's burst combo. Now, his burst string recently got nerfed. It's not quite as strong as it was last patch, but you could still look out for some crazy burst damage on the side of the blue team here.
Yeah, so I expect... Probably most likely in the blue team, we will be seeing more cautious play because of that nerf. I think it's only like 50-ish damage now. I haven't double-checked the exact numbers because they changed quite a few and didn't really go into great detail in the patch notes, sadly.
Well, here we go, and we are right out the gates. Both teams charging into the center. Crayola chucking some boulders. Snipe canceling out there from the red team's Jade player. You see, he's starting up these snipes and then canceling them, trying to keep blue team off guard. Never giving a big tell on when he's going to unleash it. He did there. Didn't connect, though.
That was an unfortunate miss. Although, thankfully, no counters. But yeah, that's the difficult thing with two counters coming out of there. And all the counter timing did not quite work out for White Crayola. Took a bit of damage, but overall, shouldn't be too bad. And once again, avoiding the counters. Vapid being quite clever, making sure to avoid that. And White Crayola just getting out of position, sadly.
Yeah, charged all the way in the right field there. Stepping up, center orb has just spawned. I don't see teams going for it. Lion Doorknocker unleashed an ulti there, but got petrified, so only got half value out of that meter.
Ooh, and that was a very nice counter, though, coming out there from JD. And the orb looks like it got taken by the blue team, but that...
Did you catch the M2 from the Rook? He jumped to the Toxic right before it was about ready to pop, so he took no damage from the Croak ulti there. Lion Doorknocker gets petrified again. Sirius unleashed an ulti. It's doing crazy damage to LDK. He kills the Rook and goes down at the same time. We're down to a 1v1.
And it will be an interesting 1v1. There's an advantage for Vapid for health. JD14, though, has been quite scary so far. And getting more energy, so they probably will try to get their first combo as much as possible. And ultimate is up. Venom Wind coming in. And we're just seeing... I'm not quite sure what the logic there was. That was...
Sirius blew his space. He needs the ulti right now. Sirius has no way out. There's the ult. Perfect.
And there it is. He's and dead. Not quite. Yet. There it is. Toxic Spit finishing it off. Although, I've got to say, that was a weird bit at the very end, near the end, with White Crayola just rushing off into the distance away from the Astral Beam. It's like they didn't want to get healed or something.
Yeah.
Not quite sure what was going on there.
Maybe it was something where he already had the charge queued up and he failed to cancel it in time and just sort of, you know, let it rip. If you've got something planned in your head and you're just mashing on the key, you know, there is a slight input buffer window in this game. And if you can't cancel that, sometimes it comes out when you don't want to. I think that might have been what happened there.
That would explain it.
Anyway, going into the second round, though, yeah, a narrow victory for the red team there. Really good ulti from the Croak, recognizing Sirius' spacebar was down. Let's see how they approach this match. LDK starting off with canceled snipes, but gets petrified against Sirius going in. Rook trying to follow up on the aggression, gets the counter.
Yeah, and very nicely done, too. I mean, we're noticing cancel's timing coming from LDK doesn't seem to be quite as on point as it was in the first round, but they'll probably get back into it pretty soon. And blue team taking the orb. And at this point, Vap is taking a lot of damage.
Yeah, every time they hit a serious counter, he gets a free teleport, he gets healing, and he gets a charged weapon. And look at the Croak's HP at the top right of your screen. He's down to 29. It's because of that serious damage. And here comes the Rook ulti.
Thankfully for the red team, didn't manage to do much. Although, it's still very dangerous. At this point, Vapid's so close to death, just trying to avoid anything, but Thankfully, they are going to be able to team up with White Krill for a little bit. Vapid going down, though, despite their best efforts. Lion Dornocker with hopefully being able to get the rockets coming out there. Or explosive shells, rather, but that's not going to be enough.
Too many counters to go against there. It's just, what is he supposed to do? He had the ulti. He tried to switch targets, but to no avail. There's too many counters to have to deal with as a Jade player there, but he had to let it rip. He had to try. And we're even one round to one.
Yeah, I don't know. That is a difficult situation. Speaking as a Jade main, I honestly, the best thing I would think to do is just avoid using Snipe altogether. Use snapshots if you have to use that. Use that cooldown. Or just stick to using revolver shots and disabling shots. And just play very careful.
Exactly that. I would really like to see LDK just start his aggression with disabling shots and revolver shots. Build the pressure with his left click because he can do that. And then once, if he can get someone to waste a counter on his left click pressure, like you're seeing right here on screen, if he was able to keep going with it, then he would be able to unleash the snipes.
Yeah, that's the thing is that, getting hit by Vapid, that's been more excusable. It's definitely a lot easier to accidentally hit counters using melee attacks, but Vapid hitting both the counters, that is going to be unfortunate, leaving the orb completely open for the blue team, and there it goes.
Yep.
Blue team is just perfect. They're fully healthy.
Excellent center control from the blue team there. They've definitely got the energy advantage, and they're trying to maintain the HP advantage here. Notice one thing we haven't talked about yet is blue team has a support, and the red team doesn't, so they can afford to step back, heal up these little confrontations they get into, where red team has a much more sense of urgency. They have to capitalize on their aggression, or they're just going to fall behind in HP like they are right now.
Yeah, and that is causing a bit of an issue, although it is Jade Croak team, and Jade Croak is all about setting up for the stuns, which is a bit surprising. We haven't seen Vapid do as many stuns, but there's Deceit coming out and not actually working.
With the end cap, that's crushing. That's one bar down the drain, and he has to wait for his camo timer to come back up. Oh, and the Jade falls to the Sirius ulti, and he cancels, keeps half his meter there. I really love the cancel
that,
on the Sirius.
That wasn't a cancel, that was a disabling shot. Right at the very end, LDK threw out a disabling shot, but didn't quite save his life.
Nice.
Or save their life, rather.
Good eye.
Yeah, cancels will always cause the ultimate meter to go, or the meter to be completely depleted if you cancel an ultimate. Fair. It's only if it's stopped, and down goes Vapid as White Crayola rushes to victory.
Excellent control out of the blue team there. That's all I can say is excellent center control. They did a great job of getting in their little scats, healing up the damage before it took down their max HP values, and just maintaining center control and fighting through the little exchanges where they could make an efficient trade. And they looked great that round.
Yeah, that definitely was their best round so far. They seem to be getting a much better sense of cohesion at this point. And White Krayola is actually hitting their stuff.
Yeah, I feel like Vapod could really use to start off the round with a camo, get a stun, because you see the Croak player backing off a little bit here. And it's okay to play cautious like that in certain comps, but when you're blowing your camos into counters and you lose all control, and Vapod's already down to 50 something HP.
And going for that camouflage attempt, but it didn't quite manage to do anything until the rush stunned them out, so that's unfortunate for them. And yet another snipe. I find it strange. LDK seems to be missing a lot of these snipes, which I can understand. It's a bit of a tricky shot to hit, but at the same time, it's like, I still don't understand the focus on snipes given the amount of counters on the field.
He's nice got an ultimate here, though, Shadow Fury, into a Croak stun. They could do some work on Sirius here.
And wait. Sirius is down.
He is down. That is the power of double DPS. That is the power of Jade Croak. They just need to keep pulling off those combos, and they can melt people.
Yeah, White Crayola seems to be very cautious. They're trying to avoid getting in very directly because they know if they're not careful. It looks like they're actually trying to, they're rushing before to possibly try to hit out Vapid when camouflage. But at this point, camouflage is off cooldown. Sorry, on cooldown, but it will be off cooldown very shortly. I know it's off cooldown again. So
Crayola's
there it is.
There's the stun. He has to pick the right time to counter. He had to do it there. He needs to go for the center orb with his ulti to get the meter back. He did.
Nice.
Now he got a kill and he's still a half meter. He won an M2 just a little bit later.
And down it goes. Oh, that one crushing blow. Even if it was a little bit later, that second Venom win coming in there from Vapid, still finishing it off. But
nothing you can do about that.
The only thing, it would have been a very clutch thing of hitting a few times, just hitting the standard, like hitting smack a few times, or pummel rather, hitting pummel a few times, just to get the cooldown of crushing blow down just enough that crushing blow got off the cooldown, and maybe it would have worked just to get out of it. But that was very close.
Yeah, for those of you in the chat who may not know exactly what we're talking about, when Rook does his crushing blow, he jumps up in the air, smashes down in front of him, but when he's in the air, he has invincibility frames. This means he cannot be damaged by any source. So even if the Croak ulti is about to explode and he times his jump correctly, he can completely avoid the damage, but he was just a little too soon at the end of that round.
Yeah, and oh, very perfect counter for that stun. That was ideal timing. They got the exact mind games down, and at this point, JD, very much out in front. A little dangerous, honestly.
They're in Vapod's head. They know his timing. Vapod, that being said, gets a nice stun on the Rook. He's armor broken and backs off because he knows he's going to be taking increased damage if he goes in. I like the play, but now he needs to find a way to help his Jade here. He gets a stun and that's good. LDK gets a snipe but goes right into the counter, giving the Rook an invuln. And now blue team up 63% life to 51. They have a slight advantage here.
Oh man, and now at this point, JD getting counters successfully, very close to getting their ultimate up. They're not using any of their EX moves. They're entirely focusing in on that Astral Beam going, but getting Explosive Shells up for LDK, getting countered, and one more good hit for LDK will finish it off, and there it is. Oh, that's gotta hurt.
Yep, Sirius got the kill, and he's got the ult on deck. Just let it go. I like the jumps from Vapod. He's sitting at about 3 bars of meter. He just got his third. He's getting close to an ulti. He's not out yet. If he can get some energy, if he can make the enemy blow their iframes and get an ult. Now, he used it a little bit prematurely.
He's camouflage. Oh, okay. God.
Sirius
okay,
was
got
able
white
to
Perilla.
Space it.
But man, that is where you need Perilla. That camouflage. Because if you use the camouflage, you can stop them from using any iframes, and then they just get the hit, and that's what you want. That is what the Croaks do. The cool Croaks. They stop you from acting.
The cool Croaks indeed, but that one's in the fog and goes down to the fog damage.
Ouch.
And blue team, being JD and White Crayola, go up 3-2. Lucky for red team, this is a 1-5.
And not 1-3.
Yeah, and not 1-3. So
they're
doing
tournament rules.
Yep, they have ample opportunity to bring it back here. And now all players fully stocked with all their battle rights, all their strengths. And we will be fighting on these terms for the rest of the match.
So at this point with JD, and White Crayola getting very, very much into the fight, but luckily, good for LDK getting out of there, and a counter, not the ideal time, the absolute worst time for JD14, and taking that hit,
the Croak timing on his camos, coming out on the stuns. He's been throwing out that counter time and time again, and he's been hitting it, but you see Vapod here starting to adapt. He's starting to wait. He's starting to not go in right away on his camos, and JD's gonna have some problems with that counter timing now if Vapod keeps doing that.
Yeah, but at this point, it is still going to be tricky because LDK did manage to get some things off with the revolver shot. And once again, we're probably seeing more revolver shot pressure. And snipe. Oh, that snipe was not a good thing to cancel. The counter was so poorly timed for it, it would have been perfect had that gone off. But it's fine. Vapad coming in with the ultimate. We will see Crushing Bullet to stop it. And that's voiding the damage. A little unfortunate
LDK
for Vapad there.
Only down to 12 life. He's been playing so passively. That's why he's canceling the snipes. Oh, gets a blast
what?
Jump, but it doesn't go across the gap. He got stuck, gained no ground, and died for it. Oh, and now it's all up to Vapod for this round. Attacks into a counter. He's getting serious. Ulti. He's going for the orb. It's the only shot he has at victory. Gets it. 50 energy. Never lose hope for Vapod.
Yeah, just go. There it is. There. I was about to say, go for the deceit, but does not manage to hit the deceit. I'm not sure what their plan was. They could have just waited a little bit, but they have another deceit that'll come up very shortly. And there's.
The Rook is not letting them get away without the price. And today, the price was paid in blood. Down goes Vapod. And another round for the blue team.
That
JD
sucks,
and White
though. Because that deceit was so close.
It was so close to being up. But we have to credit White Crayola for recognizing he had a moment to capitalize. Mm-hmm. He charged in and did.
Yeah, because that camouflage probably came out the exact frame it could, and it was still in a position where it wasn't quite able to. I mean, it was just barely, but it wasn't fast enough. And there's
this. I wish we had a stat counter for JD's success rate on his petrifies, because I feel like they are near 100% Shadow Fury. This guy has had surgical accuracy with them.
It's getting better. Every round's been getting better round to round, and the camouflage going on as well. I gotta say, the counters, that's another thing we need stats for. The amount of successful counters that blue team has had.
Rook swinging away. Lion Doorknocker pops the immaterial, gets him off him. The Rook retreats to center. Oh, but then turns around with a 180 charge.
Gotta say, though, that was a perfect blast vault. And very nice explosive shells, too. The amount of damage dealt, I mean, really, that was a trade in favor of LDK, despite being in the middle of Astral Beam that entire time. And the orb goes to the red team on top of that. So, really, red team's getting back in here. But now, down goes LDK. That was the exact wrong thing to have happen. That's what they did not want.
Unless Vapod summons all his energy from his jungle friends, there is not a joy. Just like that. I guess he didn't have the energy Shadow Fury.
No, his jungle fans are total flakes.
I mean, he spits, he cuts, he dies, he does everything.
He does.
Congratulations to the blue team. They played awesome. They had the center control. They had the patience to poke at the enemy, take a little bit of damage, and then back off and heal it up. And when you're poking at double DPS, it's very hard for double DPS to deal with that, because they don't have the ability to back off and heal up from their trades without center control. And I really feel like that was the story of the map. I mean, JD had excellent petrifies, he had good counters, and he was able, with White Crayola's help, of course, to hold center and make sure that they didn't give that HP and energy to the double DPS through those power-ups, and that secured them the victory, I think. So good job to that team.
Yeah, that really did the trick. The only thing I can think of that would really have helped for the red team would be making sure, because I think they're playing Jade Croak, and Jade Croak is a very aggressive team, but they were playing it more passively than you usually see a Jade Croak play, because, well, that's, like you said, not a team that works well when you're dealing with poking back and forth. It's a team that you have to rush in, stun, snipe, disabling shot, fire a bunch of shots, cut a bunch of times. You just keep attacking relentlessly. Even through their counters, just keep on attacking, no matter what.
You have to be fearless to run double DPS in this game, and you have to be extremely coordinated to make sure you get value off of each and every time you engage the enemy. It's critical. If you engage without getting value, or if you engage without denting into their max HP at least, you're just going to lose the battle of attrition. You're going to lose the battle of resources, especially if you can't maintain center control. But we're moving on to the next match here. So we've shuffled the teams a bit. Now it is Lion Doorknocker and White Crayola versus JD and Vapod. And we may be seeing some hero changes here.
We are seeing entirely, except White Crayola. White Crayola sticking with their Rook, but everybody else just mixing it up. And LDK going for the Baco, which we were talking about before. This will be interesting.
This is his old main, Shadow Fury. So he's played the better part of 1,500 matches on Baco alone, and I've seen him play in the past. I've had the pleasure of playing with him on my team through the ladder, and he had mastery of the character. He's been very disheartened about the nerfs as of late, but we'll see. Already I can tell you he's not going the traditional build of last patch.
Well, no, because the traditional build of last patch is no longer the build to go for. That's the whole point.
Yep. So we see him specking Warlord's Axe. He's no longer building a shield charge where they would get that very long range charge plus the stun on the tier 2 battle right. But we see him specking his axe to have a 1.5 seconds fading snare. So let's see how much harassment he can put out with those right clicks that you saw him open the match with. See how much harassment he can put out on the 2 range of the blue team.
Yeah, this is... Oh, wow. 2 melee versus 2 range. Didn't even notice this at first. But yeah, indeed, this is actually going quite in the favor of the red team, because last thing that blue team wants is to have people near them, and the counter coming out, so Berserk coming in from White Crayola. This is just ideal for the red team. It's everything they want.
Yep, the blue team's getting a bit split up here. White Crayola is taking some damage. He has a snack. He gets some HP back by eating that meat. I would like to see red team. They could easily retreat to center right now. They could easily retreat to center and get the orb, but Lion Doorknocker says, no, I'd rather have the kill.
Well, I mean, they got the kill. There's nothing wrong with that. But nope, at this point, though, it is a bit tricky. The ultimate's probably going to come out for JD, even though I don't agree with using Older's ultimate that often. I can see that this is likely to be used. I don't see any Chrono Bolts coming in here. Oh, there's the Stone Glass. Never mind. We are seeing that meteor used for some crowd control.
Yep. opted for the Petrify. He tried to set up some damage off of it, but didn't quite get it. He's got his ultimate again, and he saw that Lion Doorknocker used his spacebar, hits him with the ult. He's going for the damage combo follow-up. He got some good damage, but he's getting in-capped and just batted around by the Rook. This isn't looking good.
Perfect shifting sands to get out of there, but that's the... Oh, that boulder toss. There was nothing they could really do.
Yep.
I mean, outside of... if they don't have shifting sands, they haven't got anything to get out of there.
So close, but so far.
Yeah, the only hope is if they'd stopped attacking for a second and moved, they might have dodged it. But not when they're attacking. They're moving too slow.
I think the blue team needs to... they need to establish mid control right off the bat. They started the match on the back foot. They started the match outside of the center, near their spawn, and got pushed to spawn instantly. I love that they just
there
charged right into the middle of this match.
There it is. And I mean, now the bulwark's down... we still need... I don't know. Is Berserk going to go down? Berserk's not gone up yet, so Rook's still waiting on that. Probably... there it is. There's the counter, and...
and got stunned!
Nothing's happening. Yes, and that is exactly perfect. And there is the Firestorm. I was waiting for that. So I knew that I was waiting for the counter.
Yep, that was the absolute correct play on the... on the Ashka there. Older ulti coming out. Gets on the Bako, and so much damage went out on LDK. He's down to 12.
That... down to nothing. Ooh, now.
He's down to nothing.
But then the counter coming in for White Crayola. I mean, White Crayola is in such a bad spot right now. I mean, they are playing Rook, so it's kind of a double-edged sword. On the one hand, they've got plenty of shots to get out of here and just deal the damage. On the other hand, if they mess anything up, they're done. They can get that orb, though.
They can't afford to play with this guy. They can't give him the orb. They cannot give Rook the orb. All right. But Pod secured it there, and now Rook is going to have a very hard time coming back. There it is. So one round up for the blue team. We're tied up now. And what could you do as the red team there? Your aggression worked out so perfectly the first round. You were able to charge at the enemy. You were able to get full mid control. You were able to push them up against your spawn, and it worked. And they met very little resistance the first round. But the second round, blue team adapted. They acknowledged. They said, okay, we see your rays of two giant melee charging at us. and we're gonna raise you to range, charging right at you. Deal with it.
And it was
unexpected.
I think what it is that, I mean, Mount Rez Day is a very wall-heavy map. But what does it matter? Bakos aren't being built for walls anymore. So sure. I think blue team knows that. They've got nothing to fear, really, in the center of the map as they did last patch.
They can definitely deal with the walls. They just need to establish control and make sure they're not getting closed into any corners. That's the key point. And getting surrounded by melee like Vapod just did, he's gonna lose life.
Yes, no, speaking of getting stuck in corners, but red team taking that orb and the counter going for White Crayola. And at this point, Vapod's like two shots away from getting killed. The rush, the shot, there it is. Oh, and
he goes down, but Rook just with a sliver of life, living on a prayer. If he gets caught by this, he's done, and we're down to a 1v1. Oh, no! I made a mistake! He lives!
No, the only hope that JD had at that point was essentially doing their time travel close enough to get their orb to then do the really powerful Sands of Time Chronobolt combo. Like Sands of Time Chronobolt Quicksand stuff to just get all the damage. Because you can't do that unless you have Inspiration Battle, right? Which I don't know if JD's going to get. But, and actually you can't get, never mind. You can't even get that as older. So you basically need to pick up that energy and then use that energy if you want to do it after your ultimate in a 1v2 situation.
Indeed. I thought he had a chance to kill the Rook there and then try to handle the 1v1, which supports are notoriously good at because they can just heal up all the damage. So if you can just get to that 1v1, you know, it's always such an exciting prospect, but wasn't able to get there. And red team's up.
I gotta say, though, it looks like Lion Doorknocker is going for a lot of the rights that basically are for survivability. Like extra damage reduction, extra shielding, like all the things that just make it easier to stay alive. And I think that's going to be really that's going to make a lot of sense here. I mean, they can't use the walls easily, so you might as well just not take damage.
Indeed, and he's getting the center orb for him and his teammate right now, and Lion Doorknocker's almost at 3 bars. He's just got his 3rd bar, so he's nearing ultimate levels. Watch out for this guy, but already gets it! And down!
What?
The
fin left combo, why not? It still works, right?
It still almost works if they don't have any mobility to get out of the combo, but... I like his patience here. He's getting the center orb. He's getting the HP orbs. His Rook's getting a little bit lit up, but Lion Doorknocker knows that if he can just deny the resources from JD for the rest of this match, that together with White Crayola, they're going to be able to take him down.
Yeah, they're getting very aggressive, though. Those Time Benders luckily for LDK, Timebender doesn't actually bounce back melee attacks, just stuns you. So it's not like they have to worry about getting a Blood Axe to the face or a Meat Bolt to the face.
Oh,
but still.
The EX usage of the charge there to knock him into the fog from the Bakko, it was beautiful.
Yeah, that shield dash. You don't see that used often. There it again!
Again
for the win!
A sudden death killer. That if you, for those of you viewers at home, if he just uses his normal shield dash, he will follow him into the fog. They will go in together, and his enemy, yeah, right. So he's going to take damage from it, and his enemy's not going to get pushed as far. But if you just spend that 1 meter, you can just send him all the way deep into the fog and at no risk of your own HP. So that's when you know someone's got their character figured out. That's the kind of plays you see after someone's played their character for 1,500 matches. So very good stuff to LDK there.
Yeah, and also if anyone's watching who's in the free weekend tournament, hit the shift button when you're playing. You get to see the EX moves, and they're really handy. They cost meter, but they're very useful. It's
as displayed at the end of that round.
Yes. They win you rounds. But anyway,
so here we have the double melee DPS. JD opts to petrify one. He's probably going for the double there, but the double pet, but he gets one and space bar is away. So he's defenseless right now. If the red team recognizes that he doesn't have a space bar up or his teleport, they could go on him, but they decide not to. They back off and they're just slowly approaching blue team and getting what damage they can here.
That was some perfect dodging from Papad though. Like definitely had the timings right, but the ultimate coming in and the ultimate being avoided thanks to the patch. That was entirely thanks to that patch changing the hitboxes. Holy crap.
And then I like how Vapod tried to knock him back afterwards right into the bulwark. Denied.
Well, it was worth a shot, but yeah, you can kind of expect that bulwark's coming in. It is a Bakko, an experienced Bakko. And the ultimate missing, double ult missing. Oh, that is not what they want. No.
Soul crushing for blue team here. They need to get together. They need to compose themselves. They need to go for this orb. They get it, there's some of their energy back, but Vapod is in trouble, and he spacebars into the center.
And at this point though, at the same time, we do have White Crayole almost dead, but this is still gonna be an uphill battle, even 1v1 for an older, but there's the time travel. There's the Valiant Leap away from the time travel, and no easy way.
Oh, and he attacks into the counter. So Rook is invulnerable after that counter, and he gets this attack speed buff, and he is just swinging for the fences here against this poor older JD. What do you have for us, man? You've got 3 bars, no ultimate. You're getting close to an ulti, but you're knocked into the fog. What do you
There's
do
time travel.
From here?
Yeah, well,
he's got it.
It might be. There it is. And getting the stun,
Connects.
Getting the combo. No, not getting the combo. Oh, getting shield bashed away. Right before they managed to do anything,
Goodness.
I could have seen that.
You have to be so quick on the left click into the quicksand toss right after that time travel land. You've got to be on point. You can get it out so quick, but any delay is going to result in you getting interrupted on your quicksand, and you know what happens next.
Well, we saw what happens next. Those shield bashes are just... They are... Or shield slam. No, shield bash. Shield slam. Yeah, it's deadly. And I gotta be careful about that. And at this point, bit of a split up here, and that's fine for red team, not so much for blue team. Blue team does not want to get that close. And once again,
Blind
being forced out of center.
Yep, dashing the orb away from the enemy team. I love it, that center orb, trying to get it as far away from his enemies as possible so he can secure the kill, and he did. And so red team's got the energy advantage here that you see Lion Doorknocker using on his absorb shield, getting a fair trade on JD there. And red team's got the pressure, all the momentum's in their favor right now.
Oh, but the Bulwark coming out there, and, sorry, Bulwark, the Firestorm coming out there and getting countered, getting the vulnerability for White Crayola. Not going to do much, but there's time travel forcing the Valiant Leap. But where's the follow-up? There's no follow-up! There's the Ultimate coming in! The Heroic Charge into the Shield Dash, causing Blue Team to be almost dead. Vapod just desperate.
At a 28-55 HP disadvantage. Blue team gets a moment on that double petrify from the older to try to compose themselves. The older's trying to heal up. He needs to get renew on his teammate, on his Ashka, so he can get that HP ticking. But Ashka's in so much trouble, and he gets caught by the right click from Bakko, throwing that axe across the plains. What a snipe.
Yeah, I mean, I gotta say that Pure Fire was desperate too, because Ashka being Ashka, Pure Fire is good, but if you can, or rather, Searing Fire, but it's like if you can avoid you gotta poison your ultimate. And if you can't use your ultimate, if you can't use the infernal, like, it's just, you can't do anything.
Ultimate Shadow Fury,
and there
it
is! There is the end of the match. But yeah, if Ashka doesn't have their ultimate, they can't win, because that's what Ashka's big meter thing is. But of course, Baku with their ultimate, we see once again Heroic Charge finishing the job. It's like Heroic Charge and Shield Slam. Those are the scary things with Baku.
So JD and White Crayola won the first game.
Mm-hmm.
And Lion Doorknocker and White Crayola won the second. White Crayola seems to be the teammate to have in this exhibition series.
That, yeah, it's a good point. Although a lot of it seems to come down to hero choices too. But we'll see how that goes. Let's see what happens again in the third possible configuration of these.
Indeed. Do you think we should continue to shuffle the teams?
Yeah.
All right. Well, I'm just inviting everyone in right now then. Hopefully you all at Twitch chat are enjoying the action. Feel free to talk at us in the chat, and we would love to hear from you. Oh. And
yeah, so this is... We're going to have JD and LDK against White Crayola and Vaped, which I'm very curious to see how it's going to go.
Yes, so JD and Lion Doorknocker, both fairly high-ranked players on the MMR ladder. Lion Doorknocker, I know for sure, is within the top 1,000 players globally. So that's putting them at like the top 1% of the MMR ladder. White Crayola and Vaped, players who I don't think have played as much on the ladder, but we're seeing out of White Crayola that he's won every match that he's played in this exhibition. So maybe the rank isn't the determining factor here, and maybe White Crayola knows something we don't.
Yeah, they seem to have a little bit of warm-up period in the first game, but now at this point, they've got their counters on point, they've got their rushes on point. They've been doing very good work. So I want to see that continue. Just waiting for them to get ready. There they are. So now, what teams are we going to have this time? What compositions are we going to have this time?
Yeah, I don't know if we're going to see Lion Doorknocker stay on the Baku. He is still hovering over it. I think he's going to end up switching.
Yeah.
Try to give us a bit of a match here. He's been practicing Shifu, and I don't know if the stream can see it, but he's currently locked in on Shifu, so this will be very interesting to see.
Yeah, so you have JD on Baku, possibly, LDK on Shifu, definitely, and White Krill on Vaped, still the same as last time. So what is going to happen? And the stream wants Iva. Eva. I can't blame Indeed. You. She's pretty neat.
Baku and Shifu, I think that's what the cool kids refer to as a Zerg comp, Shadow Fury. Oh, but wow, the dramatic switches. And okay.
Okay, it's not like your opponent can see you. We don't need to do these fake outs here.
Yeah, what a change of heart. All right, so let's get in here and discuss these teams. What do we have? We have JD on Taya paired with Lion Doorknocker as Pearl. It's a very solid comp. You've got range DPS, range support.
Range stopping you from doing everything.
Yes, the Pearl can keep you from getting to the Taya, and the Taya can work off of the Pearl space control pretty well. So that's a very solid team. And then we've got White Crayola and Vaped on double DPS Rook Ashka. Now, I don't know how much synergy Rook Ashka has, but let's see what those two have in store for us here.
I think there's some stuff you can do between using Flame Strike and Rush. I mean, that's the only thing I can really think of. And we actually
Possibly.
See the attempt right there, but not working out, getting canceled. And not managing to do a whole lot, but now we got the coming in.
And
JD
White Crayola is in a spot where he's used his space bar, he's used his charge, he's used his M2 for the hop, he's used his counter, and he's without cooldowns here. And luckily for him, the blue team has not capitalized yet, at least. They're mostly focusing on Vaped.
And at this point, Vaped is taking pretty well. They're not taking all that much damage, all things considered, given the amount of focus they've had. They've been dodging pretty well. They've been getting away from... They haven't actually worried about much charged volatile water. And now Red Team taking the orb, so that is actually working out nicely. I mean, granted, Jaws did manage to eat up Vaped, but Vaped coming in with their ultimate. They're probably going to go down. There they go down. And with the silence coming on, White Crayola, that's not what they want. But they might be able to pull this off.
trying to use some meter to get some HP back, but it's looking grim. He's going for the energy orbs here, you see on your screen, tossing some boulders, but whoo! Good thing he countered there, because those boomerangs were swinging around the wall, and they had White Crayola's name written all over it! He's doing some work on Taya here! He's got a chance with his ult!
If he can hit! If they can hit, that's the one thing! Those misses were... that... oh, that would have been a dead Taya.
I mean, love the
LDK was
the
so
ult versus
hard,
ult play there. Yeah. Crayola was... right, JD or LDK was fine, but you saw the Rook and the Taya getting close to managing, like, one was going to kill the other. The tension was high, and the Rook player did his ult, and then the Taya player, JD, used his ult, and what you guys might not know is that Taya's ult also gives her an absorb shield. So that was so smart to use there. It gave her the absorb shield. She absorbed some of the damage of White Crayola's ult on his Rook and was managed
dodged
to survive.
Most of it.
Yep.
Really just dodged most of it because the mount, like, very quick mounting is the real strength of that. And the counter coming in for LDK, so getting a bit of silence going on there, but getting countered. At the same time, though, still getting that silence. Like, so many charged volatile waters. Just about killing White Crayola 20 seconds into the match.
Anytime you see that Pearl Staff glowing pink, as right now, her next attack is going to do bonus damage and silence, as it did on the Rook. And now the Rook just charges away. He has nothing. He does nothing there to do. He gets behind on the trade and has to leave. And he's at the point now where he's pretty much out of this fight. He has to retreat. He has to throw some boulders, try to stay alive, but he doesn't. Taya tracks him down, and that was the play. That was the play there for sure. Letting him escape may have been costly in the long run. So I'm really glad to see JD, leave center for a little bit, which isn't always the best idea, but left and track down the road.
That was perfect searing flight, though, just to get out of there, get out of that Jaws. I mean, it's tougher of a pod. Oh, but they get hit, combining the boomerang and the charged vault of water to finish them off. That is right as they get the ultimate, too. That has gotta hurt.
Not only did his HP value get reduced to zero, and he was KO'd, but he was silenced, so he couldn't even scream in agony when he died. That's depressing. That's depressing.
That is horrifying, yes.
Come on, Lion Dornhager, lighten up, man. No need to be so dark.
But at any rate, we still have another possibly five, I mean, they still got rounds. Red team's not done yet.
Yep, no, not by any means. Blue team has started really strong, but I would just like to see maybe not so much aggression out of Ashka. They're really going to have to line up this Ashka stun with the Rook charge, like I think you hinted at right at the beginning, but instead they don't seem coordinated with their approach, and Vapod gets caught with a Wind Bomb X-Strike combo, and he's just trying to get Taya off of him right now, but he's so low HP. It's not looking good for Vapod.
And finally getting the orb, at the very least, a bit of a break for the red team, but at the same time, that's Vapod going down. But yeah, I was thinking, like, it's just the miss and the aggression. I mean, the aggression I can kind of see from Vapod, but White Crayola missing the rush at the very start, and now they're in a situation where everything's just coming at them, and the counter's their only hope.
Why is that damage legal? Why is that legal? Somebody call the police, please! JD is a monster! He's on a rampage! This man can't be stopped! Look at the damage! He did 400 damage that round. And the enemy team's DPS, the red team's DPS, only managed to do around 100. JD doing so much damage, and while he's doing the damage, he's getting the stuns off the X-Strikes, he's getting the disorients off of his Wind Bombs, he is playing like an absolute monster. He's playing absolutely out of his mind right now. And White Crayola and Vapod need to take an anti-Taya approach. They need to save their movement abilities for the Taya's Wind Bomb. They need to make sure they do not get Wind Bomb X-Strike comboed, because it is destroying them, Shadow Fury.
Well, if they stay together, that'll at least be something. It's very clear that the rush just there from White Crayola was meant to stay close to Vapod. Now Vapod and White Crayola split by a wall, and Blue Team taking full advantage of that. LDK taking some damage, gonna silence, missing the silence! But getting another silence and managing to pull it off.
The Rook charged in there, and Lion Dornhager had the reactions to counter it as the charge started moving. Such great reactions there. And I mean, that's the kind of thing you see at the highest level of play of battle, right? So it's going to be hard for White Crayola to deal with.
Although I got to be honest, Red Team is actually managing to get the position. I mean, they have the center. As long as they can get the orb, they should be fine. But more sounds are coming
in
there.
Even on HP?
Yeah, but that's the thing. They are. And
that's center. Orb and the double!
What?
Double pearl! I'm surprised Lion Doorknocker threw them to the bottom there. If he would have thrown them up, they or up towards the center more, they may have been able to combo, but that's neither here nor there. Moving on, Taya's got her ultimate. She doesn't hit the counter, and White Crayola is in trouble here.
Oh, but at this point, Molten Chains, perfect Molten Chains, though. It's the best hope they have. As long as they can crowd control, keep this 2v1 in their favor. That might work, but no! It's going to be a 2v1 against them, and not very long for that one either.
Ouch. The X strikes are just, he has a sniper's accuracy with these X strikes. He lands X strike after X strike after X strike. JD is just on a tear. They can't stay in the range of Taya. And it's hard because they're going to get someone like Lion Doorknocker that, you know, when White Crayola uses his charge to charge in, Lion Doorknocker can react to it and get the counter, but he needs to save it for the Taya Wind Bomb so he can charge out of those X strikes.
Yeah, we see that. And we saw the last game, the opening of the round, Red Team had a better shot going forward. And now, going more for the Taya again, another rush coming in there, and they had a double rush battle, right? And they want Taya dead.
This also works. If you can manage to both coordinate your aggression, coordinate all your burst on the Taya, as the red team did at the beginning of this round, they get a stun from the Ashka. Oh, perfect. Perfect knockback from Taya.
I didn't even know he could actually knock back the rush like that, but learn something new every day, I guess.
It has to be timed so perfect.
Oh, yeah.
You have to hit them with the knockback right before they... and they kill the Ashka there. They've got two ultimates on deck. Oh, Shadow Fury, what can the Rook do here?
Well, not die for a start, but that's the hard part. And then we will see... Actually, are we going to see Companion coming in anytime soon? No Companion call. I don't think it's even going to be the kill option. Oh, there it is. There's the Companion call. There's the hit. There's the counter.
There's the counter, but it's not even relevant at this point. He's able to just outmaneuver the Rook and get enough damage to clean up the match. So, you know, well fought on both teams, but when you've got a pearl like Lion Doorknocker who's just relentlessly silencing you, and when you've got a Taya like JD that is just landing X strike after X strike, it's so difficult for a Rook and an Ashka to deal with. And you saw how strong the team synergy out of LDK and JD was there. They may have been outpicked on character select there, Shadow Fury.
Yeah, that didn't help. I mean, it's just tough when you have, I don't quite understand. Oops. I don't quite understand the double DPS setup. Like, I kind of get it, but it always strikes me as somewhat unreliable. Jade Croak I kind of get, because you have a lot of stun synergy you can do. But unless you have something that allows you to deal, like, 100 damage in 5 seconds, there's not, and, like, that can't be dealt with. I'm not really sure what the options are.
It just it requires setup, and it requires an extreme amount of coordination to pull off. They have to be able to align their burst, and they have to be able to, you know, lock the opponent down and then fire off their burst in harmony. And in short of that, you're just gonna slowly whittle down throughout the round at best. But I mean, we saw the damage come out from the Pearl Taya, and that's with the support. And they sometimes the rounds were over even quick.
Okay.
Even quick against double DPS.
Okay. But Pearl is the damage support. Like, Pearl has the healing, yeah, but those charged... I mean, we didn't even see any unstable bubbles, actually, come to think of it. It was just charged volatile waters. Every single one of them is 22 damage. Every single one of those, like... And you could just do one after another. You can get dive, do it. Counter, do it. They didn't charge it themselves, but still, that's at least 44 damage, no problem.
Indeed. And we definitely saw it there. Let's see what we're going to have in
JD's
this next
being nice.
Match.
Being nice to stream, going for Eva.
Are we going to see the Iva pick?
We are, indeed. They're doing it for the stream. What a show person. They're a good sport. And LDK going for Lucy with White Crayola going for Shifu.
Oh, that's one scary...
I know, right?
Of a team composition, especially for an Iva Croak.
Oh, yeah, because it's all about statuses, because Iva's Taser and her Zap. I mean, Clarity Potion deals with that. And then Vapod, the camouflage mostly, but the stun as well. There's a lot of things. The stun and in-cap. There's a spell block coming in to stun as well. And just, yes, this team is all about statuses, and Lucy is all about stopping that.
Yep. Really look out for the Lucy and her Clarity Potion usage, dispelling buffs and debuffs. respectively. Look out for the Shifu putting out consistent pressure. And Iva is a fairly mobile range DPS, especially when she gets that U-turn battle right, so she can jetpack twice. But Shifu's got an answer for every jetpack she has.
Well, yeah,
so although, I'll be interested to see how this pans out.
I mean, U-turn's a bit risky. Against melee composition, it makes sense because it's a bit hard for them to get back to where you started, but that's still a bit of a risky thing to do. And now at this point, we do have the taser. We do have the clarity potion to stop that, but a little late and not able to do the panic flash. So at this point, LDK isn't able to do much control for the next few seconds.
Yep, LDK took some damage. He needs to burn some heals on himself now before any other damage eats into his max HP.
And that flamethrower against the counter, I'm guessing we're going to see a lot of flamethrowers coming from JD, because that is Eva's thing. I mean, machine gun's all well and good, but a flamethrower is so wonderful.
Oh, and there's machine gun too. Out of Eva here, and it is obliterating LDK. He's down to 56 life. If he really needs to toss some heals on himself, you see him starting to do it now. He tosses out an ulti, as does his Shifu, and they are fighting back in this round. We're pretty even on life, actually dead even.
And I don't see, there it is. There's the Venom Wind. I was wondering when that was going to happen. And indeed, it does. And LDK almost dead, getting the taser off. So White Krilla also getting tasered as well. But good panic flash coming in from LDK. With only 25 health, they have some chance managing to heal themselves up. But still, this is pressure. Not too much, though. Still pretty even.
Oh, Croak didn't get anything out of that camo. He needs to play safe until his camo is back up. Iva's about to drop. Nice zap on herself to take off the deadly injection, and she is firing into the Shifu, and counter does not save him because he went for the kill with the flamethrower, which counts as a beam or an AoE that beats counters, goes right through, will not trigger, and blue team, what an excellent finish to that very, very close round.
No kidding. I mean, that... We saw a flamethrower twice. We're going to see it a lot more because there's nothing Shifu can do about that using his counter. Obviously, there's Fleetfoot. Fleetfoot, you can get away from it, no problem. But White Krayola is going to have to get comfortable with canceling their counter into Fleetfoot or just running away.
I would love to see that out of White Krayola. It's the second he notices his counter is being burnt, he needs to use that interrupt key, cancel it, save himself the time of day where he's just getting melted by the Iva, and he needs to get out of there as quick as he can, whether it's from harpooning away, fleet footing away, preferably if he has that immaterial so he doesn't take any more damage. Let's see if he makes that adaptation. But JD starting off with a 24 damage rocket right to the mouth, and Vapod going in off that pressure.
Oh, like and the Kunju not managing to do anything, all the taser as well, but the camouflage not ready yet. There it is, there's the camouflage, there's the hit, and no Kunju to get out of there. Kunju for the follow-up, but once again, Vapod adapting very well to those counters. They've really gotten used to dealing with that.
Yep, White Krayola managed to get the orb for his team, which is great, but uses his fleet, but he gets the counter and is barriered by his Lucy, but now he really doesn't have much to protect himself with, and if JD recognizes this and goes in with a flamethrower, this is massive damage.
And actually, it wasn't that massive damage. It didn't manage to hit. Thankfully, White Krayola, they weren't countering, but still, they're very close to death. But as long as they're not countering, they can at least run away and avoid some of the damage. But double kill between just the Venom Wind. Venom Wind alone. Bam.
They got cooked up. They got fried up.
I mean, how often do you see Venom Wind splash damage winning a match?
Yeah, that may have been a first for me, Shadow Fury.
That was definitely a first for me. I've got to say, you got to remember, Venom Wind, it deals splash damage. It deals quite a bit, actually.
Yep. Blue team up 2 rounds to nothing here. Lion Doorknocker and White Crayola seem to be... I mean, the pressure out of this team on the Croak Iva. I thought the Lucy was going to be able to shut them down. But Lucy, a very, very high skill ceiling character. You have to be able to use all her abilities to keep people off of you. And if you mess up and you miss a panic... or waste a panic or a clarity, I mean, it spells doom for you or your teammate.
Yeah.
She gets a panic
there we go.
Completely waste this camo. That's a great start.
Yes, that's exactly what they need, as long as they can keep that up. But unfortunately, red team is getting kind of pressured out of here. They're trying to flip this around, trying to judo that into the center, but no, JD is on that. Still taking a lot of damage. The flamethrower not managing to do as much. White Krayola is adapted.
He got some cleave damage there, but I don't think the trade was in his favor. I liked that the Lion Doorknocker went for a Petrify on Croak earlier. I'd like to see him do it again just to get that Croak off of him. He goes for the Panic instead.
Yeah, the Panic worked, but that means Petrify Bolt is on cooldown as well. At this point, it's just a matter of red team is staying together. Oh, clarity potion on the taser.
The barrier out of Lion Doorknocker got chewed through. Lucky blue team isn't able to get on top of him right now. Oh, but there he comes! There comes JD with the flamethrower again! And each time he does that, it costs him 2 meter, costs him 50 energy. But it is worth it if he can connect all that damage.
Yeah, this one we are seeing Tempest Rush coming in here from White Crayola. Try to heal up just a bit, because White Crayola in a very bad spot, and the counter being saved by the barrier, that was it! Well, the barrier was there, that saved it, thankfully, for White Crayola, but still, this is not an ideal situation. And we are going to see a flamethrower going up against Whirlwind, and Whirlwind winning the trade.
That ult. Hits the counter. JD's in trouble here.
He goes
for the force field. It made it to where he wasn't taking any damage there. He gets out alive, but he needs to get those greens. He needs to get that HP. He's up to 46 life now. The red team's taunting the Croak, who's also down to 16, and he leaps into the center. This could be it.
Okay. JD was on point with that jump. Like, they had to rocket out of there, otherwise they would, or jetpack rather, out of there, otherwise they would have been killed by
any
the impale.
Any mistake out of the blue team here, and they face certain death. And Lion Doorknocker sitting on an ult that he throws on the Iva. Clarity pushes him back into it, and he's defenseless. What a play out of LDK. Got him the kill there.
Best use of Clarity Potion this round. Or this match, I think, actually.
And then it looks like Vapod's going to be short to follow, and it is. And red team is on the scoreboard.
Nicely done. I got to say, though, that we are seeing Lucy isn't really a character whose ultimate is her main strength. But it's nice to see managing to pull that in, especially with good use of Clarity Potion. Because, I mean, throwing off her goo into Clarity Potion just to get them back in, it's a clever use of Clarity Potion. You don't see a whole lot, but when you use it, it can work really beautifully.
Oh, I get excited every time I see it. I love the combo and just using your skill kit in creative ways to make sure you get as much damage as you can. If that's not playing optimal, I don't know what is. Croak, wow, what counter timing out of White Crayola there to know he was going to get attacked out of stealth in that exact moment and read that out of a pod, that was beautiful. What a pretty counter.
Like I said, White Crayola has been doing a good job adapting to the counter stuff. I mean, as you know, Vapod has also kind of been, like, they've both been adapted to it. It's been beautiful to watch. It's been a wonderful dance of how they just keep in mind what the other has been doing, what the other's likely to do. And counter advance, though, that completely nullifying my previous statements. Or at least, mind games got out mind gamed.
Man, if you look at the HP totals at the top of your screen, I don't think it fairly tells the story. White Crayola has so little life here. LDK's sitting on full, but I feel like blue team had all the pressure, but they let it slip with that orb kill. I'm not sure where they're going to go from here. JD says, I'm going to go right into my flamethrower and try to get a kill on this Shifu, but he falls just short. Can he finish it?
No, yes. The impale. Oh, yes. Yeah, I guess filling up the Shifu, but the impales. That was a second impale, unfortunately, for White Crayola, they missed. And both of them actually against JD. JD would be dead right now, but it's like, oh no, sorry. First one was against Vapod, second one was against JD. So that's still very unfortunate. And perfect jetpack away from that crippling goo. That hurts.
Dies in the own goo, and blue team fires right back and said, yeah, you got your round, but we're taking it right back to where we started. We're taking that victory, and we're up 3-1 in this set.
I don't know. Red team's doing pretty well. I mean, there was a couple of missed attacks that were key, but red team's still doing quite well. They have several rounds they can get back in this, though they're not out of this yet by any means. They just have to...
By any means.
Yeah, they just have to make sure to play that cautious game they were playing that third round that they took it. Slightly cautious, but with the right rush down at the right time.
Of course, you see both teams charging in the center. I like that neither are getting scared. Neither are surrendering mid-control. It is a constant fight for the mid-control here in this match.
Well, yeah, I mean, that is the key thing. So those of you who aren't super familiar with Battle Rite, that center orb, go for that. That is your key. That is basically the key objective. You get that, you get a bunch of health and energy. It's very useful. And the blue team takes it, although the blue team kind of needed it at this point.
Yeah, even they took some shots to get it. You can think of it as HP when you kill that orb, but if you take too much damage getting it really isn't worth it. You have to make sure you can get it safely or quickly and efficiently at least, because JD has taken so much damage here. He's forced to fall back, but he's in position to get another orb, and he does. And that's great. That bumps him up to 89, and blue team is almost at two ulties on deck. They're very, very close.
Although, clearly, we're not going to see any ultimates coming out of JD anytime soon. But there's the Whirlwind. There's a Venomwind to counter the Whirlwind. And there's the roll to get out of the Venomwind. And looks like Fleetfoot coming out of White Crayola as well. But White Crayola in a much worse position. Avoiding the
JD's
Taser.
In trouble.
One good impale. There it is. JD was in trouble.
Able to finish the kill. Yep. Yep. He fell. And White Crayola is going to finish up the kill on that center orb. He's blinded right now, can't see much, but when Vapod dashes in there, I think he's gonna be able to find his mark with that spear. And oh wow, what a read on the camo.
That was the second one. Harpoon. That was the second javelin, the first javelin right at the start of the round as well. Like, White Crayola.
He dodged a camo stun with
yeah, he dodged a camo stun right at the start of that round.
Wow.
It wasn't a big deal. I thought it might have been coincidence, but that's the second time that happened.
Like, you know, earlier I was questioning, does White Crayola know something we don't? I think this guy knows all the times to use his iframes because this is looking incredible.
Yeah, they've definitely got that. But once again, Vapod getting panicked. Vapod's getting hit a lot more by panics recently. And perfect counter against the Taser, stopping that perfectly, but not managing to get the impales off of that. Those jetpacks coming in. JD's going to use that jetpack every time they're in a tight spot.
Yeah, and JD using his jetpack to get center and try to get the orb, but White Crayola gets it. Javelins in. Oh, and avoids the flamethrower damage. That's great. He opts for his EX Fleetfoot there to try to get some damage. Doesn't get, or try to get some life back, but doesn't get much. Blows a counter that JD pumps the flamethrower right into, and he's gonna get a kill here if White Crayola's not careful.
Oh, and White Crayola was insufficiently careful. At the same time, LDK was taking loads of damage from Vapod. This...
Wow, so much action going on at the same time that round. They broke it into two 1v1s. They said, just screw this team play thing. I mean, we know it's a 2v2 exhibition and all, but we're just gonna win both our 1v1s. How's that sound?
Yeah. I mean, I gotta say, I'm a bit surprised that LDK didn't do self-cast clarity potions when they were getting attacked by Vapod. Because that's the counter. When you're dealing with camouflage as Lucy, you throw those self-cast clarity potions and you either avoid the camouflage by knocking them away, or you avoid the stun if they hit. But once again, stun coming in there.
Yep, Vapod just lands one on the Lucy, and blue team has momentum to capitalize on Lucy here. She's down to 110 half HP. She's less than 50% life here. Oiled on, and JD goes for the flamethrower, but doesn't get too much out of it there.
And the red and blue team's taking that orb. Red team losing that just barely, but we will have, oh no, proper impale coming in there. Vapod getting out of there in time, and Vapod with Venomwind.
Double croak ulti.
Ooh, I was wondering, I thought maybe she would be able to get out of there, but no, there's no roller barrier. That's it, and that is it. That is the match.
That was huge. The croak ult was huge to recognize that they didn't have much to deal with it, and they were all nicely bunched up at the top of the map. I love the play for just letting that ult rip as soon as he got out of there and getting the damage and getting the kills. What a way to end it.
That's definitely it. And I think that's going to be it for this stream tonight. So thank you all for watching. Thank you, Faros, for joining me. It was lovely to have you.
Of course. Thanks for having me. I appreciate the time watching some high-level battle, right? I appreciate the practice and the commentary. I'd love to do it anytime. So thank you, my man.
Yeah, so and good job to all the players. I mean, White Crayola, I think with 3-1 there, just about.
Not bad.
Oh, no, 2-2, 2-2, 2-2, because that was the one we had where they were with Vapod. But yeah, still, good job. I mean, White Crayola's definitely got some good stuff. Vapod as well. It was a lot of Croak's ultimate. They knew when to do their stuff.
Yeah, we saw some big plays. We saw some big javelins out of the Shifu using that invincibility frames to dodge, stuns, just get out of pressure. We saw excellent spacebar usage and flamethrower usage out of the Iva player, JD there.
Yeah, jetpack and flamethrowers, nuts.
We saw some good ulties. We saw some good plays. We saw some good adaptations in the first couple games. Really proud of the players here. I think they put on a good show.
Yeah, so thank you the players for coming and playing. So yeah, hope you enjoyed that and have a good night, everyone. Also, actually, before we go, we're both part of the Pro Rivalry League, or both caster for Pro Rivalry League, and we have a tournament this Saturday at 7 p.m. EST. It's open 2v2 tournament, so feel free to join up. We'd love to have you in the tournament. Love to have you play. It's $500 prize pool as well, so that doesn't get you excited. then
I don't know what will. No reason not to enter. There's going to be a lot of people. You might surprise yourself, even if you're new to the game. You know, if you can keep those emotions under control and work well under pressure, that's something not all players can do. And even if they might have experience on you, even if they might have some player skill on you, you can just manage to keep those emotions on lock, so to speak, and you can manage to remain calm and try to execute with your teammate. Who knows? You might go farther in the bracket than you think, and we would love to see you there.
So yeah, with that out of the way, that is everything. So we're done. Thank you for watching, and have a good night.
Good night, all.